It is wonderful to be able to deliver this message to you. I think, as you know, I was not able to be in your midst today. And I've been tasked to talk on the topic of when the Reformed faith confronts witchcraft. I'm not sure about you, but when you think about this theme, you may wonder if it's not a action, a title movie or so. Because in a long time in the past, we used to have movies like When the West Meet the East, or When the East Meets the West, then you expect a duel of cowboys or so fighting with guns. But this is not the intention of the title of the topic. It is designed really to look at the Reformed faith and how it confronts witchcraft, especially in Africa. Brothers and sisters, the year was 1470. The town was Basel. There was a court hearing. The accused was a rooster. The rooster was accused of laying an egg, and roosters were not allowed to lay eggs because rooster eggs were used only in making witch ointment. The rooster was convicted and banned in the public square. Around the same period, witches in New England were banned, having been accused of causing frost in summer, for destroying crops with hail, for causing storms, for making cows go dry, and even for sowing the beer. These are real stories which happened here in the West. Today, such stories sound like myth, if not fictions. Why? Because with the development in science and technology, such beliefs and stories came to be regarded as superstition. When stories similar to this or worse than those from the West are heard from Africa about witches, many people carry the same hope that with the dawn of civilization and development in Africa, stories rooted in belief in witchcraft will be history. Education, civilization, and development will dig the grave and bury the belief in witchcraft. Many hope that soon in Africa, belief in witchcraft will be an issue of the past, that will be nothing more than a superstition. However, to the shock of many, this was not the case for Africa. In fact, what we are seeing is the resurgence of belief in witchcraft, and the speed at which it is growing, it is really alarming. Feeling its impact, many are asking, what is the cause of this resurgence and what can be done about it? Maybe the more important question to ask is, why should we take time to talk about this topic? Well, this topic requires our attention for several reasons, which I want to state merely in passing without elaborating on them. These reasons come mainly out of my context in South Africa. However, they may apply to other parts of Africa as well. The first is the question of human rights. The link between human rights violations and belief in witchcraft is a serious one. The victimization of women, children, disabled, and the elderly on the basis of witchcraft accusation has raised a loud cry which needs to be listened to. Many of these victims were killed through mob justice simply because they were accused of witchcraft involvement. Therefore, if this issue is not addressed, many will continue to be victimized and end up being killed because they are accused of being witches. The second reason is the problem of underdevelopment in Africa. One of the main contributors to underdevelopment in Africa is the fear of witchcraft. The fear of witchcraft has big impact on personal development. And as we know, personal development is important for the development of a society and a nation. Addressing the ills of colonialism is the third reason we need to address this topic. The effort to redress the evils of colonialism has raised two challenges for our topic. The first challenge is the issue of African identity. It's the call to embrace African identity. This call has led many people claiming in public that they have answered the call of their ancestors to be traditional healers, which in this lecture or this topic, I will call them Sangomas. Therefore, many take the path of initiation to be traditional healers. The difficult line to draw is that of really distinguishing between being a traditional healer and practicing witchcraft. This is so because of the common belief that every traditional healer has a potential to practice witchcraft. The second factor related to the practice of African traditional healing and how it relates to the Western practice of healing. Here the question asked is, why is the African traditional method of healing not acknowledged and given room in the national health practice? In acknowledging the African traditional way of healing, should we also acknowledge healing methods related to witchcraft-related diseases? Is not acknowledging these African healing methods a way of institutionalizing belief in witchcraft? The fourth reason is the question of evil and how to address it. Belief in witchcraft plays a big role in explaining the reality of evil and how to address it. Belief in witchcraft is a means of helping people make sense of evil, of evil things happening in their lives and the lives of others. And it is also a means to help them to address the problem of evil. The fifth reason, which deserves our attention, is the problem of syncretism. I think one of the problems found within the mainline African churches is that of syncretism. Most missionaries who came to Africa treated belief in witchcraft as a myth. As a result, it was not properly addressed, while people who became members in these churches were struggling daily with the fear of witchcraft. This has meant that you had members in the church who claimed to be Christians, yet at the same time, they were visiting traditional healers to address fears and issues related to witchcraft. Since these issues of witchcraft were not properly addressed by the churches. Maybe by now, you should be asking yourself, what is this belief in witchcraft? If this is such a serious issue, how do we address it? Well, this paper will first of all give a definition of witchcraft. We will then discuss the pillars that sustain belief in witchcraft, as well as the reform response to belief in witchcraft. First, defining witchcraft. One of the challenges of speaking and writing about belief in witchcraft in Africa is the problem of definition. The problem has two aspects. The first is the issue or the use of the English word witchcraft. The word fails to express fully what belief in witchcraft is all about in the African context. At the same time, there is no better way to replace this already known word. And the second aspect to this problem is the difference in the practice of witchcraft in Africa. Due to the varied cultures and beliefs within Africa, it is difficult to talk in general about belief in witchcraft. For these reasons, my definition is based on the general understanding of belief in witchcraft from the area I grew up in, Soshanguve. A typical word used in my area to speak about witchcraft is the word buloi. In my Northern Sotho language, the word implies a process of mixing things to achieve a desired goal. The verb form of the word is loya and is used daily, especially in relation to the preparation of the staple meals known as pap or sadza, which is made from maize. The food is made through the process of boiling water, adding some salt, and adding the maize flour to the boiling water, and mixing well to the point that the mixture is smooth. After it has cooked for some time, one can then say, Bohobe buloyile, meaning the pap is well cooked. So, when it comes to witchcraft, how do the mixtures work? One must first understand that within the African context, the foundation for understanding witchcraft is that everyone has the potential of being a witch. This is so because witchcraft is a matter of the heart. It is rooted in the heart. Among many other things which the heart can mean, one of the meanings is that the heart possesses some form of power. Some call it a life force or a vital force. This power or life force can be increased and it can also exert influence on other forces and be influenced by them. Well, a simple example is when a man offends his parents and does not seek forgiveness and reconciliation with them. The parents can hold their hearts against him. Well, holding their heart is a literal translation from my vernacular, which can be equal to holding a grudge, but it implies something more than that. The result is that whatever he may try to do in his life may turn out to be negative. This will be so till he comes back for forgiveness with the hope that the parents will understand and release their hearts against him. Things can be worse if the parents die in that condition of holding the grudge. This practice of holding the heart against someone has resulted in many children accusing their parents of bewitching them. By this, they mean parents are holding their hearts against them and hindering their success or their progress in life. However, one must remember that the ability of holding the heart against someone is not only limited to parents. All individuals have it. Therefore, everyone has a potential to be a witch. One can say that holding the heart is witchcraft practice internalized. Witchcraft practice can also be externalized because witchcraft is seen to be rooted in the heart. When one does not have the ability or his vital force cannot work the desired end, he can consult those who are able to manipulate the spiritual powers to help him achieve his desire or the desires of his heart. This is where it becomes tricky. Because every sangoma, a traditional healer, has the potential to use the powers he has to bewitch others. So some sangomas choose to exercise these powers while others choose not to exercise them. As a result, those who use these powers to bewitch others are known as sangomas of death. And while those who choose not to use these powers are known as sangomas of life. However, there is also the other side. This is someone who is by nature a witch. They only know how to make things in order to bring about evil ends. So this later group does not need to be consulted, whereas the former, the sangomas of death, can be consulted for a fee. This consultation is not always about evil ends, let us remember. It can also be about seeking some good ends. You can consult the sangoma because you want to harm someone, but you can also consult the sangoma to protect yourself. In the case of protection, a woman can consult the sangoma to gain some muti or a concoction so that her husband will love only her, which we call a love potion. In her eyes, she's seeking what is good for her family. However, if the husband discovers that the wife did something like that, he will accuse her of being a witch. Therefore, from this understanding, A witch is not only the one who dispenses the concoction, it is also the one who made the consultation. Since this consultation can be done by anyone, therefore anyone can be a witch. One would realize that this folk understanding of witchcraft is a bit different from the understanding offered in academic studies on witchcraft in Africa. Depending on how one looks at it, witchcraft not only functions to define what is evil, it can only function to seek what some see to be good for them, like keeping a lover. To understand this definition better, then I think it's good to understand then the pillars that sustains the belief in witchcraft. And this is the second point I want to communicate with you. To understand the significance of witchcraft in the life of the people, we must see belief in witchcraft as functioning on the level of a worldview. People believe in witchcraft plays a huge role in how they view reality and how they make sense of it. Therefore, any attempt to address witchcraft must do so on the level of a worldview. Belief in witchcraft is what defines the daily life of many African people. To understand the necessity of belief in witchcraft, we must understand the five pillars of the African worldview. One is the pillar of the relationship between the material and the spiritual world. The second is the role of honor and shame, the role of envy, the concept of limited good, and the belief about man. Well, let's take the first one, the relationship between the material and the spiritual world. For some time, the African worldview has been understood as the relationship between the material and the spiritual in terms of animism. If by animism people mean the belief that objects, places, and creatures all possess a distinct spiritual essence, then this is not the African understanding. The African understanding can be explained in the following way. First is that some living things possess certain powers which are characteristics to the thing or parts of that living thing. These powers can be harnessed and used to advance some certain purpose. As an example, the reproductive parts of humans and the breast of a woman have the power to multiply. If one wants to be successful in his business, he may need to gain these parts. However, these parts work best if they are taken from the person while he's still alive. In this way, you are able to capture their power. Then, these parts will be taken to a sangoma or a traditional healer, especially the sangomas of death, who can keep these powers in those body parts so that the parts can be used with their powers to attract people to your business. Once this is done, you can take these parts and bury them at the gate entrance of your business. If the process of taking the parts and burying them is done well, clients will flock to your business. However, these powers do not last forever. They need to be renewed according to the time frame given by the sangoma. Failure to do so will result in those powers working against you. The other side of the belief is that some non-living things can be filled with some powers. Well, one of the common stories which one often hears is that of sex locking. If a man wants to protect his wife against adultery, he can do a sex locking. Here, the man can buy a padlock, which is a non-living thing, and take it to a sangoma to work on it. Then it will be locked. Locking it means that any man except the husband who engages in sexual intercourse with his wife will be interlocked to her and they cannot be separated. Here the locking function of the padlock is used to symbolize the spiritual powers of sex locking. The emphasis here is that as long as this belief of the interaction between the spiritual world with the material world is maintained, then witchcraft practice will always be necessary. Well, the second pillar is that of the role of honor and shame. The African worldview has been classified as honor and shame orientated. If honor is understood to be the worth, value, prestige, and reputation which an individual claims and which is acknowledged by others, and shame to be the opposite of that, then the idea of shame and honor permeates every form of life in Africa. To live before the eyes of others occupies the biggest place in the daily life of many Africans. Therefore, daily life is shaped by gaining honor, embracing positive shame, and shunning negative shame. Basically, it means other people's perception of you is what shapes your daily behavior and appearance. The implication this has is two-sided. For those possessing honor, anyone who is perceived to be a threat to their honor may need to be dealt with. To those seeking honor, anyone who is a hindrance to their path in gaining honor may need to be dealt with. A simple example would be that of a wealthy person who is known to be perhaps generous, provided he's helping his community. And if someone else within the community may also be rising to be wealthy, this newcomer will be seen as a threat to the current wealthy person. To maintain his honor, he may have to eliminate this up-and-coming one, and this elimination can be undertaken by the use of witchcraft. The third pillar of the African worldview is the role of envy. Well, it has been acknowledged that envy provides the context for understanding the practice of witchcraft. It is not an exaggeration to say that it is a common belief in Africa that for every good you acquire, there is someone envious of you. Here, envy should not be confused with jealousy. While jealousy seeks to keep what one has, envy seeks to destroy that which one has. Envy is the feeling that if someone else has something that you do not have, they are to blame for that reality. The principal motive in envy is not to take, but is to destroy. The envious one acts against the object of his envy, not to benefit himself, but to cut off the other person down to his own level or below. What troubles the envious one most is not what he lacks, but what others have. However, he does not want to keep what they have, nor does he want them to have it. Therefore, because of the popular assumption that for every success you gain, there is someone envious of you, and that those who are envious can act on their envy, and the means to doing so is often through witchcraft, there is a high demand for protection among Africans. This mentality on envy covers all areas of life, from buying a new car or a pair of shoes, buying a house, getting a simple job, to getting a professional one. Understanding the thinking produced by envy, there are three implications we need to know. First, one must try as much as possible to avoid being envied, because this makes you an object of witchcraft. And second, one must avoid being perceived as the envious one, because this will result in you being accused of witchcraft in the loss of others. Third, it means trust is at its lowest among Africans, especially when it comes to trusting those close to you, because they know you the best and are thus most dangerous to hinder your success. The more people know about you, the easier it is that they can bewitch you. So secrecy is important. So do not reveal more about yourself be suspicious of those asking many questions about your life, because you never know who is seeking to bewitch you. In a sense, one can say envy creates a context where one is assumed guilty until proven innocent. As long as envy continues to play such a role in the lives of people, belief in witchcraft will always be the norm. Well, the fourth pillar is the concept of limited good. Due to the fact that his village church could not manage to support his stipend, this pastor went to learn some farming skills from his Western friends in order that he may develop his church community and himself. Afterward, he started planting maize crops, utilizing the new farming skills he had learned. The result was that his crops produced more and were bigger than his neighbor's crops. In trying to understand these differences between the crops, the neighbor went to consult the Sangoma. He was informed by the Sangoma that the pastor is a dangerous person, for he used some spiritual forces to extract all the nutrients from the soil of the neighbors and directed them to his soil in his yard where he grew his crops. That's how his maize crops became bigger and multiplied, while theirs remained small. The pastor's neighbor informed others in the village of his findings about the pastor. The next morning, after the neighbor informed the fellow villagers, the pastor was shocked to see the people from the village at his gate accusing him of practicing witchcraft. The reaction by the pastor's neighbor is what some call the mentality of limited good or the zero-sum game. It is the belief that when one gains, another loses. Therefore, gaining more than others is always perceived as being done at the expense of others. As a result, one who is able to produce more or gain more than others will always be treated with suspicion, since there is a potential that he may be using some witchcraft. Therefore, the idea of limited good is a fertile ground for the belief in witchcraft. The fifth pillar is the belief about men. Well, another pillar which continues to sustain belief in witchcraft and fear of it is rooted in the African belief about men. To make this understandable to you, allow me to phrase it this way. It is commonly held among many Africans that human being consists of body, soul, and a shadow or a aurora. In my language, they call it the siriti. What is important to note is that this division of the human being is used to explain certain behaviors and action of some individuals. Because there are those with witchcraft powers who are able to separate your spirit or shadow from your physical body. And since the spirit represents the real you, the people with witchcraft powers can use your spirit or shadow to perform certain labors on their behalf. This separation of body from spirit often happens during the night or at death. One of the symptoms is that when you wake up in the morning, you wake up feeling tired. Normally, of course, when you are sleeping, your body should rest, and therefore you should wake up feeling refreshed. When you wake up feeling tired, it means someone came during the night and took your spirit or shadow from you. While it looked like you were sleeping, you were actually busy working somewhere. It is important then that one is able to protect himself against such people, the night people. At the same time, such protection can be deemed by others as the practice of witchcraft. Therefore, understanding belief in witchcraft within an African worldview helps us to see its significance in the daily lives of the people. In a sense, one can say belief in witchcraft seeks to answer three fundamental questions. Why are things as they are? How can one make things to work to his or her advantage? How can one maintain things as he or she wants them to be? At the heart of belief in witchcraft is man trying to take control of his life and directing it where he wants it to go, be it in addressing issues related to success, dealing with failure, addressing the problem of evil and misfortune, keeping the social order, gaining protection and power. In this context, then, one can ask if there is hope for Africa in dealing with this issue of witchcraft. Well, it is my conviction that the reformed expression of the faith has the answer to this dilemma. And this is what we look at as our final point, the reformed faith response to witchcraft. If we are to confront the belief in witchcraft as explained above, we have to do it from the level of a worldview. Essentially, there are four things needed to change a worldview. First, there must be a story to tell. Second, there must be institutions which are carriers of the story. Third, there are rituals which normally celebrate important events of the story. And fourth, there are symbols which are reminders to the events of the story. It is my conviction that the Reformed understanding of the Bible is the most suited to address the issue of belief in witchcraft on the level of a worldview. The Reformed faith has a story to tell, which has God as the center. The institution of family, church, and school has always been understood as basic ones in carrying the story. The understanding of worship, shaped by living our life before God and before the face of God, and reformed liturgy are essential in celebrating this story. The place of sacraments and the place of the Lord's Day and some special Christian holidays are reminders of the great events of the story. However, while I agree that covering these four essential aspects of changing a worldview is important in confronting a belief in witchcraft, it is not within the scope of this paper to address all four of them. For this paper, we'll focus only on one aspect of this worldview, which is the story. And therefore, to highlight some features of this story, I invite you to turn with me to our text, which is 1 Corinthians chapter 8, and then I'll read for you verses 4 to 6. 1 Corinthians chapter 8, and then verses 4 to 6, God's word read as follows. Therefore, as to the eating of food offered to idols, we know that an idol has no real existence, and that there is no God but one. For although there may be so-called gods in heaven or on earth, as indeed there are many gods and many lords, yet for us there is one God, the Father, from whom are all things and for whom we exist, and one Lord Jesus Christ, through whom are all things and through whom we exist. Well, our text forms part of the bigger context of the text where Paul is addressing the thorny issue of eating food sacrificed to idols. It is his answer to how Christians should understand idols, which forms our focus. Just like idols, belief in witchcraft is rooted in self-worship. If idol is a result of a man trying to create a god in his own image, a god he can control and manipulate, then so is the belief in witchcraft. The center here is man. It is man taking charge of his life. Man trying to drive the journey of his life. It is man trying to make sense of his life without reference to God. And this happens both in the practice of witchcraft and the protection against it. Therefore, as Paul warned the Corinthians later in chapter 10, verse 19 to 20, that food sacrificed to idols are offered to demons, so is belief in witchcraft. At the heart of it is Satan keeping men captive through this fear of witchcraft. It is man blinded by his sin and the power of the prince of this world. And the question is, how did Paul respond and how to respond to this reality? First, we need to be strong and affirm our confession. This is where Paul starts. But for us, did you see that? Meaning, we as Christians, we stand on a different ground. Our lives are defined not by things, but by someone. Not by impersonal powers, but by a personal God. We need, therefore, to teach our people to find their strength in what we confess. And the second, we respond not by preaching about man and his needs, but pointing first to the one true God who is triune. This is where Paul starts, and this is where we must start. God, the Trinity, consisting of one divine substance and three co-equal and co-eternal persons, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. This is the ontological foundation of the Christian story. And if this is not the God we refer to, then we have no God. So we have to talk about the triune God. And third, we need to be more specific about this God. This means preaching him as the Father. In preaching God as the Father, we have no option but to preach that the Father is the Creator. Creation comes from God and is being brought to him because it exists for him. It is all about God from beginning to end. Remember how this truth of confessing God as the Father is summarized for us in Lost Day 9 of the Heidelberg Catechism. Well, the question is, what do you believe when you say, I believe in God the Father, Almighty Creator of heaven and earth? The answer is that the eternal Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who out of nothing created heaven and earth and all that is in them, and who still upholds and governs them by his eternal counsel and providence, is for the sake of Christ's Son, my God and my Father. In him I trust so completely as to have no doubt that he will provide me with all things necessary for body and soul, and will also tend to my good whatever adversity he sends me in this life of sorrow. He is able to do so as Almighty God and willing also as a faithful Father. And in Lost Day 10, it continues to ask, what do you understand by the providence of God? That God's providence is his almighty and ever-present power, whereby, as with his hand, he still upholds heaven and earth and all creatures, and so governs them that live and breed, rain and drought, fruit and barren years, food and drink, health and sickness, riches and poverty. Indeed, all things come to us not by chance, but by his fatherly hand. Think unpacking this concept of God then will deal a death blow to the belief in witchcraft. So third, we must preach God as the Father. Fourth, we need to preach Jesus as the means of accomplishing all of the Father's intentions for his creation. As Paul says, all things were created through him and for him. Therefore, we need to preach him in the following way. We need to preach him as Jesus, meaning he is the complete Savior. We need to preach him as the Christ, meaning as a prophet, we have in him the full revelation of God in him. Christ is enough. We do not need any extra information from a prophet or a sangoma. As our priest, his sacrifice was enough. We did not try to manipulate God for our favor. And as we speak now, Christ is interceding for us. We need to preach him as king. He governs us through the word and spirit, and that he defends and preserves us. But we need also to preach him as the Son of God, meaning in him we have our adoption. We are true sons and daughters of God. We have God as our Father because of Christ. Therefore, we have God full protection in Christ. But also we need to preach him as Lord, meaning he owns us. He moved us from the kingdom of Satan to his own position. Body and soul, you belong to him. Therefore, nothing can separate you from the love of your Lord. Do not fear, child of God. And lastly, we need to preach Christ as the true man, meaning he knows our experiences, all of them. He knows what it is to cry before God in prayer. He knows it all. And all the fears that may come upon us, he's able to feel and to address and to carry us through them. Fifth, maybe you are sitting there and asking yourself, how is this possible? How can this be possible? Let me point you back to the beginning of our text. Did you see how Paul started? He said, but for us. He's not saying, but for me. He's saying, but for us, meaning you and I, Corinthians. You, Corinthians, at one stage, you were part of the things. You sacrificed to idols, and your lives were gripped by this fear of so-called gods. There was a time when this us did not exist. So, how is it then possible that Paul can say, but for us? It is possible because he tells us that we have received not the spirit of the world, but the spirit who is from God, that we may understand the things freely given us by God. And we impart this in words not taught by human wisdom, but taught by the Spirit, interpreting spiritual truth to those who are spiritual. The natural person does not accept the things of the Spirit of God, for they are folly to him. He's not able to understand them because they are spiritually discerned. That is 1 Corinthians 2, verse 12 to 14. So it was possible because of the conviction well in them by the Spirit. This is our confidence too. The Holy Spirit is still working today as he broke this story of idols and removed the Corinthians from his chains. The Spirit is able to do the same to the stories rooted in belief in witchcraft and set Africans free. I'm aware, brothers and sisters, that full justice was not done to the reform view. For the sake of time, we cannot develop it further. However, it can be said that when we embrace this reform view as it confronts witchcraft belief, it brings a different story. It is a story that moves people from the kingdom of darkness to that of light. It is the story that opens men's eyes to see things in a new way. The question for you and I is that, are we going to invest ourselves and life in telling the story in Africa?